Hi. Trying to decide if this video is worth a watch? Here, I'll help. Do you have a guitar? No? Well, go buy a guitar, but you can still watch the video. If you answered yes, do you want to learn more about it? All right, watch the video. Do you know how to change the strings? No? Watch the video. Yes? Watch the video. Does your guitar go out of tune? Is the tone dull? Are the strings discolored or are they grimy? If you answered yes to any of those, sounds like you need to change the strings. And watch the video. If you play guitar less than 15 minutes per week, you should probably change your strings on average once a year. If it's about 1 to 3 times per week, 6 to 8 months will probably do. If it's 3 to 12 hours per week, change them every 3 to 5 months. And if it's 12 to 25 hours per week, they'll need a change every 1 to 3 months. So, grab a guitar or just watch. We're gonna be changing my Epiphone Les Paul strings. I know we all like to be winners, but first, I encourage you to be a looser. Yep, you heard me right. Looser. Loosen up the strings. This way, when we go to cut it, that it doesn't fling up and scratch your face, for example. Not that I speak from experience. That would be crazy. I hear it hurts. Just go ahead and do that to all the strings and then carefully pull them out. Both sides, you're gonna unwind it. So now that they're off, we just put the new ones on, right? Nope. This is a perfect opportunity to polish the body, the neck, and the pickups. I use a body polish, a neck conditioner, and chrome polish. For the pickups right there, yours may be different based on what your guitar has, but I use this Blue Magic metal polish, Dunlop body cleaner, and a Kaiser conditioner for the neck. And because we're polishing such different surfaces, I highly recommend we use 3 different microfiber cloths for each. So what I'm doing here is lifting up the tone and the volume knobs just so I can get under them and get a good polish. I'm gonna spray directly onto the cloth and not the body, and then I'm going to start polishing. Normally I would do everything on the sides and the back of the body, but I do this on a regular basis, so I'll skip it this time. And then as I'm about to dramatically show, use the other side, there we go, the other side of the cloth to just finish polishing with the drier side. This part we don't have to wait until the strings are off to be able to do. You can do this at any point in your guitar's life. Next up, we have the neck. We're going to want to condition this to give it moisture so that it doesn't dry out. I use the Kaiser Lemon Oil Conditioner. You can use whatever you want, but as the body polish, you also spray directly onto the cloth. And what I do is I polish per fret just to make sure I'm thoroughly cleaning to where I don't miss anything. And this is a pretty boring process, so I'll just speed it up there. Yeah, so just really get in there. You'll notice a nice shine after you're done. You don't need to do this every time that you change the strings, but. So here I'm backtracking because I forgot to polish the headstock, but better late than never, eh? Next, we've got the pickups. You can see on here there's a little bit of grime, and so what I use is just Blue Magic Metal Polish Cream. You can find it at an O'Reilly's, just a normal chrome polish. But beware, it is a potent smell, absolutely horrible. It will hit you harder than life itself, so be cautious. A little bit goes a long way, and you're also going to want to make sure that we're using that separate rag that we mentioned before. And now you're going to want to scrub. It's going to start giving you a black tarnish, which is okay, that's what it's supposed to do. But go ahead and finish all of the rest of your chrome hardware if you have it. If you don't, obviously don't. And then I'm going to take the body rag and go ahead and just wipe around it just to be safe in case there's any type of residue from the chrome polish. And lo and behold, we have the shiniest pickups in all of the land, so shiny you could take a mirror selfie off of them. I think it is so important to do these things to your guitar to keep it nice and clean and shining for years to come. So now that we have a nice polished and conditioned guitar, we can start to put the new strings on. I have heard wonderful things about Elixir, so I have decided to do the light gauge Elixir electric guitar strings. You're gonna find that once you start executing, you're gonna need some space between the headstock and the ground, and so I place a pillow under the neck. So once we start opening up the strings, we're gonna see that they're individually packaged. The light gauge just means the thickness of the strings is lighter. And so the smaller the number, the smaller the thickness, each one just represents 0.0, whatever the number is, inches of thickness. So the higher we get, the thicker the string and the lower the sound it's gonna be. So we're gonna start with the 46 in this case, which is the low E string. I would also highly recommend this tool. It turns the tuning knobs easier and it snips strings. It does a number of things. And be cautious when you're unwinding the string. It really hurts if it hits you in the face, or so I've heard. and here's where it pays to be sober. You're going to completely thread it through the tailpiece and pull all the way through. Keep going until, oh, we see the ball end. And then go ahead and give it one last little pull to kind of get it snug in place. And then we're going to make sure that it's situated on the bridge, which is something we will also check later. And so I was always taught that we take whichever one we're doing and we measure 1.5 tuning pegs, 1.5 to 2 above where we're going, and we go ahead and snip it there. That should give us just enough slack to be able to do the perfect amount of turns on the tuning knob. Yeah, so just give it a snip and then make sure you keep track of where your excess goes because it tends to go missing within carpets. Now you're going to thread the string through from the inside out at approximately a 45 degree angle, kind of how that arrow was just showing. And then we're going to give it a bend counterclockwise because that is eventually going to be the direction that it is curling around the tuning peg. And this is for sure going to take 2 hands, and don't feel bad if it's difficult for you at the beginning. You might even need a second person, but once you get it through, you're going to kind of bend it and you're going to make sure that your probably your right hand is pulling and putting a lot of tension on it once you start turning the tuning knob. This is where the counterclockwise part comes in. You're going to want to turn the tuning knob to where the peg is turning in a counterclockwise way if you look from an aerial view. You're going to want to keep a tight grip, and you will see here that I was not pleased with how the turns were going around the peg, so that I just went ahead and got a better grip and I got it tighter to the peg. And so you're also going to want to make sure that the turns are going from the top of the peg to the bottom. We'll get a better view of that in a second. And because it ends at the bottom, this gives the correct angle for the string to the nut. Try to keep a somewhat steady pace as you're tightening the string. You're going to start feeling the tension. You just want to be careful about where your hand's at, and you can adjust and make sure that it's laying in the right slot on the nut and that it's also on the bridge correctly. Once we have this, we can kind of adjust where our hand is and maybe start to tune it. And here is a better view of the strings around the peg. So we have now done the E string, which is the 46 thickness. Now we can move on to the next, which is going to be the 36. And it's going to go right here, right beside the E. The next one following that is the 26, and it's going to go there. And then each number after that will be on the other side of the headstock in that order. We're going to use the same measuring procedure for how much string to keep, so just guesstimate when you don't have pegs to use. When in doubt, leave plenty of slack. Also, be aware of where your string's at. Sometimes when you have other strings already done, it can somehow get on the other side of that tuning peg without you even knowing. So just be cautious. And here I am thinking that even though I have experience, I can do it backwards. Very difficult, obviously couldn't do. So I just flipped the guitar, or you could just get on the other side of the guitar just so you can reach it better. Everything is gonna be the same other than on this opposite side, you're not going to turn it counterclockwise. Instead, you're going to turn it clockwise. Some people believe that you should restring in the order of your outside strings inward to maintain the tension on the neck, but I don't think it makes that big of a difference. I would say the most important part is to make sure that as the string gets tighter, that it's in the correct nut position and that it's also on the bridge correctly. And then after, you can trim the excess. It gets really sharp though, so be careful. But then it is all ready to go. You should be in tune and ready to rock. Oh, wait. No. Okay, well, tune it again just to be safe. It might have gotten out of tune somehow. But then you're good. Okay, maybe not. But hey, that's normal. It's normal to not be in tune for a while. And so to combat this, it's good to actually give your strings a little bit of a tug, a little bit of a stretch to get the strings broken in. And that's all she wrote. Ladies and gents, we have a perfectly restrung, polished, and conditioned guitar. It's time for bed.